Glenn, we have so many people that have shown up, especially as this is, I'm going to be stepping down and retiring, so this is going to be a great, I'm glad you're all here. One of the things I would like you to always think of, and Mark Brewer and I did work with this, we started a 16-year-old can sign up for the party. Now, they can't vote for candidates at the convention, but they can vote at the convention about important things. When I started in the high school Democratic Party. They used to have it. They got rid of it. Now we got it back. Please, if you know high school kids that want to get involved, tell them that they are wanted by the Democratic Party. And it's an important thing to get the future so us old war horses can move on. The other thing I want to say is there were two other LGBT or Stonewall caucuses before us, and they didn't stay long, and we have stayed the longest. And one of the things that I want to emphasize to you is you have to be practical. You have to look for people that are going to advance the LGBT caucus cause. And I mean by that, I'm going to give you two things. There was in Washtenaw County, we had a very bad sheriff who eliminated, did not want gays, they harassed gays in Ann Arbor, you know, in Washtenaw County, surprisingly. I knew a real good guy named Jerry Clayton. And he came to me, he says, I want the LGBT support, but I'm afraid at that time he was going to lose the Black Ministers Alliance. So we didn't ask him to wave the big flag of LGBT. What we did is we kind of, okay, it might be sneaky, but this is politics and this is the way it should be. What we did is, in between the lines, the newspaper, we had a picture of me and the caucus endorsing him and all that. But when we went to the Ann Arbor News, which would go to these ministers, we talked about the fact that he was on the board of the Christian Care Network for HIV/AIDS, which kind of gave a signal to both sides that he was on their side, and it worked beautiful. He was able to get four, okay, now remember the other sheriff was harassing. He immediately started sensitivity training for gays through the police department so they would understand the rights of gay people and would not tolerate it. He also hired LGBT people. He also, and we've talked and had coffee, and he says, I wouldn't mind a transgender coming to me. Now, here's a guy that we had to kind of play games with so he could get elected, but that's reality. That is reality. Another concept that we have to worry about is some of our LGBT candidates. Obviously, we want to support anyone that goes out. But we had one in Ann Arbor that we were going to support, and we were told we have to support because she's a lesbian. And what happened in the long run is, as soon as she started talking, she didn't know the facts, she was very unclear, she didn't know where things were going. She started threatening people that were asking questions in a questionnaire for her mayor. You don't do that. And then she said, well, if you don't vote for me, you're homophobic. And I got calls from a lot of Ann Arbor Dems. The mayor that was there was so pro, he was straight, but pro-gay. Now, we had to say, no, we don't endorse this candidate because the mayor has always been there, even though he's straight. This particular lady really unraveled more and more, and it was becoming an embarrassment. But now that we separated, no, you don't have to vote for her. We've actually supported the mayor. The mayor since then has been wonderful. So sometimes you've got to use common sense. We want LGBT things pushed forward. We want 100% rights. But sometimes we got to, okay, if you can't wave, some of the representatives can't wave the LGBT flag because they're in swing districts. But when it comes to the count in Lansing, they're there for us. I'm with that. I want to see elected. So just be realistic. And also, there's a lot of interplaying in the politics within the party. Whoever gets elected, please remember that even though you may have an ideal position or an ideal person, we sometimes have to work politics and you have to make deals. Out of 45 years, that's my advice to you guys. Outside of that, we're going to have the vote, but first let's let two of the people, why don't you come up?
Thank you. It's been a long 4 years. Like Phil said, in 2009 when we came into this room, this was really my first convention that I'd ever been to. And I was really excited to come into this room, and because we all know Michigan is such a tough place to live if you're LGBT, and there was nobody in the room. And we got in, and we're like, okay, what do we do? Do we just leave and leave the party as it was? Or do we, the few of us in the room, kind of take over and try to accomplish something? And so, you know, Phil's not the type to just sit back. He will drag you with him, whether you want to volunteer or not, as many of you in the room probably know. So we decided to get the caucus up and running. It was called the Stonewall Caucus at the time, but since nobody was here, we had no records, we had no membership lists, we did want to kind of start from ground zero. And kind of thanks to a lot of you in the room, we have done quite a lot over the past 4 years. It's been kind of a rocky road. Hard to run one of these caucuses, surprisingly. But you probably can't see this, but I'll go through. I just wrote up some of the highlights of the last 4 years and kind of what the caucus has accomplished. So like Phil said, we did attend the National Equality March. We sent the largest delegation from Michigan. We sent 100 LGBT and ally members to that trip, and it was a phenomenal experience for everybody involved. We're really working hard on the anti-bullying legislation for a long time, and we were really in favor of enumeration and pushing that heavily, just educating legislators about why that's important. We have a bill now, it's not quite as strong as most of us would like, but we have something, which is a step in the right direction. So we held rallies and town halls, and we gave out information to legislators. We attended almost every Pride event over the last few years, and really the purpose of that was just to talk with LGBT people in their community about how you can get involved in politics, what it means to be an LGBT Democrat, and then to register people to vote. We've registered almost probably 2,000 new registered voters in Michigan over the last few years. We were heavily involved with the Obama for America campaign. We held conference calls with them about what do they need from the LGBT community and what do we need from them, what type of organizing tactics can we use and partner with them. So that was really, I think, a good experience for all of us in the caucus to kind of go through and have that exposure with that campaign. There has been a few party resolutions each year almost that we've seen go through because of caucus support. Like Mark Brewer was saying, we have marriage equality as part of the Democratic platform in Michigan. We also had included transgender rights in the party platform, and then June as Pride Month is officially in the party platform as well. So we're really excited that we were able to get that done. There's still a ton of work that needs to happen in the state, and I know we're excited that there's going to be some fresh leadership, and we're excited to work with them and really build this caucus to the next level. Some other things that we've done, we went to student conferences, we've done candidate endorsements. Like I said, we started out with zero members in 2009. We have over 800 members today, which is phenomenal, and we just can continue to grow from there. And so that's just a little, and we've worked on ENDA and anti-discrimination. We've done protests in Ann Arbor, in Howell, in Lansing, kind of all across the state. And work to really help engage LGBT Democrats everywhere in Michigan. But that's kind of just a few of the highlights that we've done over the last few years. Before I kind of step down, I do want to say a really big thank you to Phil. He has been a phenomenal leader to this caucus. It's been really rough going at times, but you have stood by it with such passion. And I don't know if many of you know Phil's background, but he has such a strong connection to the civil rights movement and Martin Luther King and Rosa Parks and Cesar Chavez that it's been so beneficial to have you part of this process and teaching all of the members kind of great grassroots advocacy skills. So I would just like everyone, if you can, just stand up and give Phil a round of applause.